Before we start on meiosis, let me go back and pick up one thing that I left out last time, and that is a comparison of mitosis as it occurs in animals versus in plants. Animal cells, the typical animal cell, has, of course, a cell membrane, a nucleus, as does the typical plant cell. But as you also know, there are some unique things about the typical animal cell, plant cell. That is, it has a cell wall composed of cellulose and some other complex polysaccharides. It has a cell wall that's actually outside the cell membrane. So here's the cell membrane. It also has some other unique characteristics. It may have a large vacuole in the center, a central vacuole, but it has a nucleus. And being a plant cell, if it's a leaf cell or something, it may have things like chloroplasts out here in the cytoplasm. But one thing, as I was telling you before, that the plant cell does not have are the centrioles. So we have the centrioles in the animal cell, but no centrioles in the plant cell. There are a couple of major differences that we see in the process of mitosis in plants versus animals, but really the surprising thing is how similar they are. If you look at the process of cell division, if you look at those events of the nucleus, they are very, very similar. Now, one thing that you will notice is that once the spindle fiber starts to form and the nuclear membrane disappears, remember that in animal cells, we had these spindle fibers that go from pole to pole, and some of them attached to the chromosomes, but we also had these astral rays. Those astral rays are uniquely animal cell properties. You will not see those in a plant cell. So a plant cell, let's say this would be a metaphase cell here, right? Once the chromosomes are lined up. A plant cell in metaphase starts to sort of elongate by that time a little bit. A plant cell in metaphase, the nuclear membrane would have broken down. So we have no nuclear membrane. By the way, some of these characteristics I drew over here are really differentiated plant cell structures. The chloroplast may not really be there yet in cells that are actually dividing. But the nuclear membrane will have broken down just like it did in animal cells. And the spindle apparatus will form, but you will see these spindle fibers, some going from pole to pole, some of them attaching to the chromosomes. But you do not see these other fibers, these astral rays. And of course, remember, there is no actual centriole there at the center at this pole. So no centriole, no astral rays. Actually, this absence of these astral rays has something to do with one of the other major differences, and that is the way in which cytokinesis occurs. So once we get to telophase, as you know, in plants and animal cells, telophase will occur by this pinching in process, but it happens where this contractile ring forms, where those astral rays overlapped. And so you have that contractile ring actually cutting the cell into as sort of an outside in process. Well, in plant cells, there's a completely different process of cytokinesis that goes on. In plant cells, when you get to telophase and you start to form these two new nuclei down here, the spindle apparatus will start to disappear. But what you see is the growth of a new cell wall that starts here in the middle and then grows toward the outside. So whereas in animals, cytokinesis was an outside-in process, here it's an inside-out process. This new wall starts to grow on the inside and it grows toward the outside and literally cuts the cell in two. This new cell wall has been called the cell plate. You'll also see it called the middle lamella. So those would be three major differences in the process of mitosis as it occurs in plants versus in animals. The absence of the centrioles, the absence of these astral rays, and the way in which cytokinesis occurs by the formation of a cleavage furrow in animal cells, but by way of a cell plate or a middle lamella in plant cells. So let's move on now and take a look at the process of meiosis. Meiosis. As we think about meiosis, let me just summarize again for you. Meiosis is a cell division that is going to take a diploid cell. You're going to undergo two divisions. One of them we're going to call meiosis one. And so we have this single diploid cell that's going to make two cells. And then there's another division, meiosis two, in which each one of those will divide to make four cells. And those four cells will all be haploid cells. What about these? Let's put that question off for just a little while. We're going to come back to that in just a minute. So meiosis then occurs always in two divisions. Instead of making identical cells, as does mitosis, it makes non-identical cells. These four cells will all be different from each other. They will all be haploid, whereas the original cell we started with is diploid. We also know that meiosis occurs only in those cells that are going to produce the sex cells. So in higher animals, this would occur in the ovary or in the testis. And by this process, then they take that cell and produce an egg cell or a sperm cell. So this is the process of meiosis. And as it turns out, meiosis turns out to be extremely important in understanding Mendel's rules. As I mentioned before, Mendel didn't know anything about meiosis. Chromosomes were just being discovered at Mendel's time, before he died maybe. So he knew nothing about meiosis, but the principles that he described, Mendel's rules, Mendel's laws, are actually based on meiosis. So we have to have a good understanding of meiosis in order to understand genetics. So let's take a look at the process of meiosis. A cell going through meiosis will go through an interphase just like it did as if it were going through mitosis. In other words, there'll be a G1, an S, and a G2, and during this S phase, the chromosomes are going to replicate. So when we first see those chromosomes, they have already replicated just like they had at the beginning of mitosis. So that interphase cell in an animal cell would look just like an interphase cell in mitosis. So what's going to happen? Well, we're going to have two divisions. We're going to have this cell divide into two cells. Then those two cells will divide into four cells. And the stages of meiosis are given the same names as the stages of mitosis. So this will be the first phase will be prophase, but since it is prophase of mitosis 1, we're going to call it prophase 1, and then we have metaphase 1, anaphase 1, and telophase 1. And then, of course, we're going to go into mitosis 2, and then we have prophase 2, metaphase 2, anaphase 2, and telophase 2. So, prophase 1 is a very extended, long stage. And you know what biologists like to do. If there's something that's really long, they say, hey, we need to divide this up and give it some new names, again, so that biology 333 students will have something else to learn. So prophase is actually subdivided into five subdivisions, five substages. And these stages we're going to call leptonema, pachynema, leptonema, zygonema, pachynema, diplonema, and diakinesis. How's that for subdividing things? Prophase 1 is such an elongated stage that it will be divided into these five substages: leptonema, zygonema, pachynema, diplonema, and diakinesis. The one of the reasons I want you to understand these different stages is there are some very important things going on during meiosis, as I'm sure you already know, things like synapses of chromosomes and crossing over, some things that don't go on during mitosis that happen back here during prophase, during this very elongated stage that we call prophase. So, what can we say about these? Well, leptonema, one thing we can say about these is if you're looking under a microscope, leptonema, zygonema, and pachynema look pretty much the same. The chromosomes are getting shorter and fatter. The nuclear membrane may be starting to disappear, but for the most part, leptonema, zygonema, and pachynema look like a cell with a ball of spaghetti in the middle. There's kind of, you can see the threads, but that's about it. The threads get a little shorter and fatter as you go through. So actually distinguishing under the microscope leptonema, zygonema, and pachynema is very difficult. They're really defined by the events that are happening during those substages. During leptonema, first of all of the events of mitosis are going to occur here. The nuclear membrane is going to disappear. The nucleolus is going to disappear. The spindle apparatus is going to form, and the centrioles are going to separate as the spindle apparatus forms, and the chromosomes are going to condense. So all of those events are happening, and I may not go through and draw them all in here. We could draw the spindle apparatus starting to form, although it probably doesn't form until one of these later stages, but we could draw those in. But we're really going to concentrate on the chromosomes. So at this stage, the nuclear membrane is probably still there, hasn't disappeared yet. The chromosomes have started to condense, and so you can see them, but they're still pretty much a jumble. Whereas back here, you couldn't even see them, they were so extended. You can kind of see these little threads that are found in leptonema. The chromosomes at this point have already doubled. Remember, S phase has occurred back here. But even if you looked under the highest magnification in your light microscope, you would not see those doubled threads because they are held together so tightly. They are so close together, we can't quite see them. Just like really at the beginning of a prophase of mitosis, the two sister chromatids are held so closely together by cohesin that you can't really see them. So we can't quite see that that's really two chromatids yet. So there's not really a whole lot going on here. The only thing really that's happening during leptonema is the chromosomes have started to condense. Okay, what about zygonema? During zygonema, they continue to condense. They continue to get shorter and fatter. So if we drew them, we might draw them a little bit fatter. Nuclear membrane is probably still there, hasn't quite disappeared yet. But what does happen during zygonema, a very unique event during zygonema, is the process of synapsis. The pairing of homologous chromosomes, synapsis occurs. The pairing of homologous chromosomes. So let's take a look at that process. Now, like I said, with a light microscope, you really can't watch that process happen, unfortunately. Through some very elaborate studies and with some organisms, using other means, you can actually see it, but it's very difficult to see this process. But if we could see that process, what's happening is the homologous chromosomes are pairing. Synapsis is the pairing of homologous chromosomes. So let's go back to this cell here, and let's say, I forgot to draw them with colors, let's say again that we have a cell that has a diploid number of four, diploid number four, so it has two large chromosomes. It's going to have a pair of large chromosomes and a pair of small chromosomes. I'm going to draw these as different colors because we'll say that the red ones came from the mother and the blue ones came from the father. So there's a pair of the large chromosomes and there's a pair of the small chromosomes. Now eventually we may actually be able to see them like this once we get down to these later stages, but at this point they're so elongated and the two sister chromatids are so tightly held together that it's very difficult to see the individual chromatids at all. But what is happening during this stage is those homologous chromosomes are coming together. That did not happen back here during mitosis. Remember during mitosis when we saw those chromosomes? Here may be one, and here's the homologous one over here, and here's one, and here's the homologous one over here. They are not together. But during prophase of meiosis I, the homologous chromosomes will actually come together and pair. They will synapse. They start to synapse, and evidence indicates, from their ends, what we call the telomeres, the ends of the chromosomes. They start to synapse from the ends, and the synapsis process moves toward the middle. So that if we could see, let me draw this cell instead of like what it really looks like, kind of more diagrammatic. If we could see this process, what we might see is one of these chromosomes that looks like this is in the process of coming together with its homologous partner. But it hasn't completely come together yet. Now let's make it come back over here, like this. It's in the process of pairing. It's paired in this region and in this region, and the smaller pair, maybe they're doing the same thing. You notice I'm drawing these with the ends of the chromosomes, the telomeres, the ends of the chromosomes stuck to the nuclear membrane. There is some evidence that that is true. The ends of the chromosomes seem to be associated with the nuclear membrane. And this pairing process starts from the ends of the chromosomes and sort of zips up toward the middle. So zygonema is the stage during which pairing is happening. By definition, zygonema is the stage during which this pairing process is occurring. So once those chromosomes start to pair, you're in zygonema. Once all of the chromosomes have completely paired, here there's only two pairs, but in your cells it'd be 23 pairs. Once those chromosomes have completely paired, then zygonema is finished. So by definition, zygonema is the period of time during which these chromosomes are pairing. Now, I should say one other thing about this pairing. This pairing is not a matter of, say, you know, these two chromatids coming together like this, side by side. Instead, they're really coming together probably more like this. These two are so closely linked together that you can't distinguish them under the microscope. And these two are so closely linked together that you can't distinguish them under the microscope. And they come together like this. Now, in the late part of the 20th century, looking at the electron microscope and looking at this process of pairing, it was discovered that there is a proteinaceous structure. There's some sort of a protein structure that forms between these two chromosomes as they are pairing. The proteinaceous structure forms between those two chromosomes. And that proteinaceous structure is called the synaptonemal complex. The synaptonemal complex. If you look under the electron microscope, right here at this region, you can sort of see some jumble of something over here, which are these two chromatids, let's say on the left, and then you see another little jumble of something over here, which are the two chromatids on the right, and there's some sort of a very definite protein structure in between them. And that protein structure consists of a central element and two lateral elements. So we have that central element, and then there is the two lateral elements. And this makes up the synaptonemal complex. That is the synaptonemal complex. And as synapsis occurs, this synaptonemal complex appears. So it appears very clearly that that synaptonemal complex is some sort of a proteinaceous structure that is physically holding those chromosomes together. So remember, we had the protein cohesin holding sister chromatids together, but now we have a different protein complex called the synaptonemal complex that holds the two homologous chromosomes together. The two homologous chromosomes are being held together by this synaptonemal complex. One other discovery, I don't think this is in your textbook, but one other discovery that was made back in the, I believe in the 1970s, as I remember, one other discovery was made, and that is that along the synaptonemal complex, there are little structures that form that are actually part of the next process we're going to be talking about, which is crossing over. So let me just, I'll just preview those for now, and we'll come back and talk about some little protein structures that form along the synaptonemal complex. So the synaptonemal complex can be seen with the electron microscope. The synaptonemal complex can be seen at zygonema, but it hasn't formed completely between all the chromosomes if we're still in the middle, the homologous chromosomes, if we're still in the middle of zygonema. Easy to remember, pairing zygonema, right? Because the zygo has something to do with pairs coming together, like a pair of gametes come together and form a zygote. This is a pair of chromosomes coming together and synapsing. So that's zygonema. By the way, you will sometimes see the term, instead of nema, you'll see you'll see teen here. And I don't know my Latin well enough. I don't remember if it's Latin or Greek now, actually, but I don't know my foreign language, my classical languages well enough to remember exactly the difference here. But this nema this is actually the noun form, and this is the adjective form. This is not on the test, by the way. Just in case you see leptoteen instead of leptonema, it's the same thing, but this is really the adjective. So if you said the leptoteen stage, then that would be correct. But if you just say leptonema, that's correct, because that's the name of the stage. So you'll sometimes see leptoteen, zygoteen, pachyteen, diplotene, and diakinesis. So I just wanted to point that out in case you see those terms. Leptoteen means the same thing as leptonema. Zygoteen means the same thing as zygonema. Okay, so one unique process has happened during meiosis that we did not see during mitosis, and that is the synapsis of homologous chromosomes. All the homologous pairs come together. So that at the end of zygonema, if you could see the chromosomes, it would look like, if we could see in one of your cells, it would look like you have only 23 chromosomes, because those two sister chromatids are held so tightly held together, and the two homologous chromosomes are so tightly held together, that all four of those chromatids look just like one great big thread. And so you'd only see 23 units. In this cell, we would only see 2 units because the 4 chromosomes are paired. Okay, so that's zygonema. The other, let me leave that word synapsis in there since that's a very important key process. Whoops, it only has one in, I guess. Now, during the next stage, another one of those unique events to meiosis occurs, and that is pachynema. During pachynema, the process of crossing over occurs. Another unique event to the process of meiosis. Two unique events that occur in meiosis occur back here during prophase one. One during zygonema, one during pachynema. By the way, these names don't necessarily tell you a whole lot. Lepto simply means thread. Zygo, that tells you something. That tells you that the homologous chromosomes are coming together. Pachy just means thick. You know, like a pachyderm has thick skin. This has a thick chromosome, so the chromosomes are getting shorter and fatter. Diplonema does tell us something, as we get to that a little bit later. But during pachynema, the real important thing is not that the chromosomes are getting thicker. The important thing that happens here is this is when crossing over occurs. This is when crossing over occurs. Crossing over is a reciprocal exchange between homologous chromosomes. Let me draw a picture, a diagrammatic picture of how crossing over occurs. We're going to come back a little bit later in this course and look at crossing over again from sort of a molecular point of view, from the DNA level. But for now, we're going to just look at it just from sort of the chromosome level. The easiest model for understanding what crossing over is the breakage and rejoining model. Naka said it's really a little more complicated than this, but this is, at least at the first level, it's a good illustration of how crossing over occurs. Here are two homologous chromosomes. Now remember, these two red strands are identical copies of each other. They were copied back here during S phase. These two are identical copies of each other. What's going to happen, first of all, is a breakage. One of these homologous chromosomes is going to break at some level. One of these chromatids is going to break at some level. And on the homologous chromosome, you're going to have a breakage at the same point. So, a breakage, and then a rejoining. Leaving those chromatids exactly where they are. They do not change places, they stay where they are. Now this may be sort of a really going into making a big thing out of a minor point, but it is a relatively major point that I want to make here. This crossover, after it has happened with the rejoining, is going to mean that this chromatid is now joined to that chromatid, and that chromatid, will have it kind of coming back behind, is joined to this one. So there is the finished crossover. This is what the crossover is going to look like. Now, when we see these back during Pachymema, we really can't see them. I mean, this is just one thread, and so under the microscope, it looks like this. At this point, it looks like this. At this point, it looks like this, because all four of those chromatids are so close together. But we're going to see when we get to the next stage that now these threads start to relax, the chromosomes start to kind of pull apart from each other, the cohesin disappears, and you can actually see the four chromatids, so that what we would see at the next stage is, really, we can now see those chromatids, and we see something that looks like this. We can actually now see all four of those chromatids. We won't be able to see the color, but I'm going to go ahead and draw the color here. We won't be able to see red and blue chromosomes. But what you see is these two sister chromatids are still right where they were before the crossover. And these two are right where they were before they were, where they were before the crossover, creating a point here where the crossover has occurred. And that spot where the arms are lying on top of each other, that spot right there is called the chiasma. The chiasma is the result, running off of my screen there, right? Let's write that again. The chiasma is the result of the crossover. The chiasma is going to appear at the next stage. We create the chiasma right here, but at the next stage, when the chromosomes start to kind of repel each other, we can see that chiasma, and the chiasma is going to be exactly where that crossover occurred. Now, I'm kind of making a big deal of this process, because very often in textbooks, you'll find illustrations that just flat out get it wrong. That is, you'll find a textbook that shows a couple of chromosomes that look like this. And then they'll say, okay, a crossover is going to occur, and so this happens. The arms kind of flop over each other first. Before the crossover happens, the arms do this. Lay down my marker so I can see what I'm doing here. The arms do this. Well, that's not what happens. Because what the often textbooks will illustrate is these chromosomes go through this process, and then the crossover occurs, and then after the crossover occurs, now that red is joined up to the blue, and the blue is joined up to the red. And so many times in some really good, otherwise good biology textbooks, you'll see an illustration like this of crossing over. But this is absolutely wrong. Because if this was true, the chiasma would exist only before the crossover happened. And when the crossover happened, the chiasma would disappear. We know that's not the case. We know that the chiasma occurs after the crossover has finished. So the arms do not flop over each other first and then exchange. The arms stay right where they are, and you cut this arm here and this arm here, kind of gross, huh? And join them back together, creating a chiasma. So this, again, this may be emphasizing a tiny little point, but it is something that actually led to a better understanding of what crossing over really is, and is proven by the fact that the chiasma exists only after the crossover. It does not happen. It is not present before the crossover, which this model would say. So, the end result is we have exchanged genetic material. This chromosome that did have genes that were all from your mother, well, on this chromatid right now, that chromatid now has some genes that came from your father. And so if that chromosome gets passed on to the next generation, it is not being passed on like you received it. You received that chromosome from your mother, but the one you're passing on to your children may have on that same chromosome genes from your mother and from your father. And so this brings up the process that we're going to talk about later called genetic recombination. So that process, that all-important process of crossing over, occurs during pachyonema. Like I said, we're going to come back a little bit later and look at it at the DNA level and ask, how does this happen between two DNA molecules? Ultimately, this is a reaction that happens between two DNA molecules. One other thing I want to mention is going back to this synaptonemal complex. Back in the 70s, someone discovered these little blobs. If you start looking at the synaptonemal complex, every once in a while you'll see kind of a big blob here in the middle, kind of a large protein structure sitting on the top of that synaptonemal complex. And they said, well, you know, hey, maybe this is where crossing over is happening. Maybe this is a little package of enzymes that's doing the crossing over. So someone decided to do a test of that hypothesis, a very tedious test. They took a nucleus. Now, in order to see this, you have to use electron microscope, which means you make an ultra-thin slice of the nucleus. And you're not looking at the whole nucleus, you're just looking at the whole nucleus. You're just looking at one slice of the nucleus. And then if you cut it at just the right place, in a few places, you may see this synaptonemal complex. But someone decided to do a very elaborate experiment where they did serial sections for the electron microscope, cutting these extremely thin slices of the nucleus until they had sliced the entire nucleus. I don't know how many slices it is, but it's probably up in the thousands of slices. In order to get enough slices to get to slice the whole nucleus up, and then went through and counted the total number of these little blobs that they found. And they said, okay, for one nucleus, how many of these little nodules, these little things, do we find on the synaptonemal complex? Then this was actually in Drosophila, they looked at Drosophila and said, okay, how many crossovers do we normally get in a Drosophila cell? How many of these chiasma do we normally get? And lo and behold, the two numbers pretty much agreed. And so that was pretty clear evidence that these little blobs are actually points where the crossing over is actually happening. And so they became known as recombination nodules. And if I remember right, these aren't mentioned in your textbook. That's just one. So that is a recombination nodule. It is a place, we're assuming, where there's a little packet of enzymes that's actually carrying out that reaction of exchanging one of the chromatids over here and joining it up with one of the chromatids on that side of the synaptonemal complex. So that synaptonemal complex then is going to be present. It's going to start appearing during zygonema. So it's going to be present here, and it's going to be present through pachynema. It's the chromosomes are still synapsed during pachynema. So we can see with the electron microscope, we can see that synaptonemal complex at pachynema also. Then we move into the next stage of prophase one, which is diplonema. Diplonema. Now, during diplonema, the pairing forces relax. The cohesin disappears, holding the sister chromatids together. The synaptonemal complex disappears, and the chromosomes kind of start to drift apart from each other. They almost seem to be repelling each other. But because of that, we can now see, for the first time, we can now see the sister chromatids and the two homologous chromosomes. So back here at this stage, let's just draw. Let's see, how did I have this drawn? I'll try to do it the same way I did that crossover. We're going to assume that at this point there was just one crossover on one of these two chromosomes. And we'll go ahead and say the other chromosome, let's say it didn't have a pair of, didn't have a crossover. Crossing over is, I should mention, is really the rule and not the exception. Most pairs of chromosomes will have at least one crossover. There may be two or three or four or maybe even more for a very large pair of chromosomes. Some of the smaller pairs of chromosomes sometimes might not have a crossover. So just to keep things simple, we're going to say there was only one crossover in this cell. There was one right there. In real life, there would have probably been multiple crossovers. And just because, if there were two crossovers, just because the first two involved these two chromatids doesn't mean that the second one had to also involve those two chromatids. There could have been a crossover up here between that chromatid and this one. Because remember, they're not lying like this. They're really pretty close to each other. So, the crossover has occurred, but and this is how it would look if we could see it. But now when we get to diplonema, we really can see it. So I'm not going to draw this very much different. But now these chromosomes will kind of start to repel each other. But you can now see the point at which that crossover occurred as the chiasma. So you'll see something like this. And you can see a chiasma. Aha, we had a crossover right there. You now know, because of the presence of that chiasma. The other pair down here, there's nothing really holding them together, and they may tend to start drifting apart a little bit. Now remember, during all this process, the spindle apparatus is forming, and I'm kind of ignoring all that, but we will have a spindle apparatus also. But during diplonema now, for the first time, we can see all four chromatids. Back up here, everything is so tightly synapsed that you can't see the four chromatids. In fact, very old textbooks used to say the chromosomes replicate during prophase one because it looked like there was one thread and then it turned into four as the two sister chromatids came apart. But that was actually wrong. There is an S phase back here when replication occurs. But for the first time, we can now see all four chromatids of those two synapsed chromosomes. So that's diplonema. The pairing forces now relax. The synaptonemal complex is now gone. There's nothing holding those homologous chromosomes together, except those chiasma. They're kind of tangled up there at that chiasma. And so they're sort of held together at that chiasma. And then finally, the last stage of prophase one is diakinesis. During diakinesis, the chromosomes really start to pull apart. Remember, we have spindle fibers attached to the chromosomes, and they really start tugging on them, and they start pulling apart. So that back here at diplonema, the position of the chiasma was right where the crossover happened. But as we get into diakinesis, the two chromosomes now kind of start to pull apart And so as they pull apart, the position of that chiasma slips toward the end. And so that slipping of the chiasma toward the end of the chromosome is called terminalization. Terminalization occurs during diakinesis, which simply means the chiasma starts to move toward the end of the chromosome. So if we wanted to draw that, the chromosomes are getting even shorter and fatter. And so this chromosome now, with its two chromatids, we now have that chiasma is no longer right at the position where the crossover occurred. It may have slipped a little further down, so that the chiasma is kind of now right here. If I can get this drawn right, I think I got it. My drawing's a little small, I apologize there. But can you see what we're doing? The chiasma has actually moved toward the bottom a little bit. The chiasma is no longer right at the point of the crossover. The chiasma has now migrated toward the end of the chromosome, toward the telomeres, the end of the chromosomes. Now these two chromosomes did not have a crossover, and so they kind of start to pull apart from each other during diakinesis. And so also, this then is the last stage of prophase one. So by this stage, the nuclear membrane is completely gone. Probably somewhere along in here, the nuclear membrane completely disappears. It may be starting to disappear earlier, but it's completely gone by the time we get to this point. So prophase, a very elongated process, time-wise, a process that takes quite a bit of time, but a process that's divided into these four stages, because there's some very vital things to meiosis happening here. Synapses and crossing over are happening during prophase one. Now, once we get past prophase one, the rest of this process moves along pretty quickly. So I'm going to now erase all of this and just draw a cell that's at the end of prophase one up here. And then we're going to go to metaphase one, anaphase one, telophase one, and then go on into meiosis two. So here at prophase one, let's get rid of all of this. So at the end of prophase one, we have a cell whose nuclear membrane has disappeared. We have a chromosome here. And its homologous partner over here. With the chiasma now having slipped down toward the end, terminalization has occurred. So these are pulling apart from each other, and then we've got the other pair of chromosomes in which crossing over did not occur. So we're at the end of prophase one. Now, unfortunately, I already drew these lined up, so let me redraw them so they're not lined up, so we can have something to do during metaphase. So here are these cells at the end of prophase one, the prophase of meiosis one. Now we're going to move into metaphase one. During metaphase one, now these synapsed chromosomes lined up. Not the individual chromosomes as did during mitosis, but now the synapsed chromosomes. So these chromosomes that look like they did just at the end of diakinesis now line up along this metaphase plate. So there's that chromosome. Oops, let's make that red. There's that one, and here's this one. They now line up along the metaphase plate. Of course, we have spindle fibers and centrioles and so those sorts of things. So there's metaphase one. During anaphase one, now, instead of the sister chromatids separating, as did during mitosis, now the homologous chromosomes separate. So during anaphase, this chromosome moves to the left. The red one moves to the left and the blue one moves to the right, leading with the centromere leading the way. So there's this chromosome going to the left, like this. But remember, that chromosome now has a piece of its homolog. So now they're going to pull apart. So that one's going to the left. This one over here is going to the right. This one down here is going to the left, and this one over here is going to the right. So now the homologous chromosomes separate, not the sister chromatids. The sister chromatids are still together. And then finally we go to telophase one, during which cytokinesis occurs. Now this cell is going to pinch into two, and we're going to produce two daughter cells. One of them gets this chromosome and that chromosome. That large one has a piece. It's mostly maternal chromosome, but it has a piece of the paternal chromosome. This cell over here gets this large one that's mostly paternal, but it has a piece of the maternal. The small one is all paternal. And so when this process finishes, here we've got those two cells. Now, the cells will then immediately go into meiosis II. That cell will now, both of these cells will now enter meiosis II. So this is all meiosis I. And now we have meiosis II. With prophase II. In some organisms, this cell may actually elongate and go into an interphase, but if it does, there is no S phase. The chromosomes have already replicated. There is no need to replicate them. So it's a very abbreviated interphase. In many organisms, as soon as you finish this process of dividing these two cells at telophase, they're really already in prophase. They're already in prophase II. In fact, they've already finished prophase II. The nuclear membrane is there. We've got to get the spindle fiber lined up right. So the spindle has to come in here and attach properly. But what usually happen is those two cells are going to be immediately into prophase II. So here is this cell with its two chromosomes, and so now we have to grow some spindle fibers to get ready to separate these, so the spindle apparatus will form again here. So that's prophase II, a fairly brief stage, since the chromosomes don't have to shorten. If you go directly into it, the chromosomes have to shorten. You don't have to get rid of the nuclear membrane. You got to get the spindle apparatus all set up. But once that happens, then you go directly into metaphase II. During metaphase II, the chromosomes line up, and again, I already drew them lined up. I shouldn't have already drawn them lined up, but since they are, I'll just leave that. But, you know, they may not be lined up yet, but now during this stage, they will actually align with each other. The two chromosomes line up, spindle fibers are attached, and then during anaphase II, now the sister chromatids separate. Earlier the homologous chromosomes separated, but now the sister chromatids separate, and so that red one goes to the left, the big red one and the small red one go to the left, this big red one and the small red one go to the right, but that big red one has a little piece of the blue on it, and just the opposite down here, the big blue one and the little blue one go to the right, The big blue one and the little blue one go to the left, but the big blue one has a little piece of the red on it. So they separate that way. And then finally, in telophase two, we're going to make four cells. So we have room for this. Once we get to telophase two, now that cell is going to divide into two cells. This cell is going to divide into two cells. That cell is going to divide into two cells. And we have four cells. What do we have? We have a cell over here with a large maternal chromosome and a small maternal chromosome. The other cell has a chromosome that's, the large one is from the mother, it's maternal, but it has a piece of the paternal, and the small one is maternal. Over here, for this cell, we get, so that's what this cell becomes, is those two cells. This cell becomes these two cells. And so it has this chromosome with a little piece of the maternal on it, and this combination of chromosomes. So we get four cells from this process. And so meiosis is now finished. So what have we done? Well, obviously, we've gone from diploid, a cell that had four chromosomes, to four haploid cells, four cells that have a single chromosome. Notice one other thing. The four cells we have made, they're obviously not like the parent cell, because they're haploid and it was diploid. But notice the four cells we have made are now different from each other. They're all different from each other. Now, this wouldn't be true if there had been no crossover. Without a crossover, these two would have been identical and these two would have been identical. But remember, crossing over is not the exception, it's the rule. So crossing over is always going to happen. So I didn't lie to you. Meiosis is an asexual process. It is a process that produces non-identical cells. There are those four cells. None of them are like each other. That's why sexual reproduction produces different organisms. You are not genetically identical to your brother and sister, unless they're an identical twin, and then that happened with something after meiosis. Started off from the same fertilized egg. Otherwise, you may have similarities with your brothers and sisters, but every time your parents make a sperm or an egg, they make a different sperm and egg. Therefore, they will never end up making two identical ones. You can calculate the probability of that, actually. You can calculate the probability at least of making two identical sperm or eggs by two different meioses if there were no crossing over. Now, with an organism with just two pairs of chromosomes, it might not be that difficult. But remember, you have 23 pairs of chromosomes. So let's say meiosis happens one time and you get sperm number one, and this is the one that turns into you, and then later it happens again to produce sperm number two, which turns into your brother. What are the chances that those two sperm are identical? Well, even without meiosis, it's nearly zero. That is, the chance that they both had the same number one chromosome is one out of two. The chance that they had both the number one and the number two chromosome is one out of two times one out of two. The chance that you had the number one, the two, and the number three chromosome is one half times one half times one half. Well, you've got 23 of these, so you keep on doing that 23 times. The chance is 1/2 to the 23rd power. 1/2 to the 23rd power. And if you take that 2 to the 23rd power, it comes out something in the neighborhood, I believe, of, let me just do it. Let me pull my trusty calculator out here and see what 2 to the 23rd power turns out to be. Alrighty, 2 y to the x, 23, equals 8 million. So this is 1 over 2 to the 23rd power. That's what this value turns out to be, right? That's 1 out of 8 million 388,608. So we'll just say 8 million. Even if there were no crossing over, the chance that that sperm and then one produced later would be identical is 1 out of 8 million for humans. Now we throw in crossovers. Every time meiosis happens, a different number of crossovers are going to happen at different positions, and this number becomes so astronomically large, the denominator becomes so astronomically large that we can say there is no chance. There is no chance that two individuals produced by two different meiosis would end up with the same gamete. Now, in order for you to be identical, they'd have to happen with the egg and the sperm. And so it's going to be, we're going to put even another factor in here. It's going to be this 1 out of 8 million times 1 out of 8 million for the chance of that happening without crossing over. And so with crossing over, we can say there is no chance that you can be genetically identical to your brother and sister without being an identical twin. So this turns out to be important from more of an evolutionary point of view, in that it's going to say that sexual reproduction is really good at recombining genes, producing a tremendous variety of offspring. And if you know anything about evolutionary theory, you know that the presence of a variety of offspring is necessary in order to drive evolution. So there is the process of meiosis. I have some illustrations that I want to show you. One of these, if you look at this figure right here, you can see actually a pair of synapsed chromosomes that are probably that lower figure is one of those chromosomes. At the top, this is actually grasshopper chromosomes, a male grasshopper chromosomes as it's producing sperm, and you can see the synapsed chromosomes there. Kind of hard to tell what those are, but at the bottom there is one of those pairs of chromosomes kind of blown up, and you can almost see the four chromatids. Now there at the bottom where you actually see the chiasma, you can. So there is actually a place there right at the bottom of that diagram where you can see something that looks like this. Now it's really hard to see that this is two chromatids right here. It just kind of looks like one thread, but you can actually see where the two chromatids cross there to create the chiasma. So there's a real nice photograph of a chiasma. And then you have some other illustrations from your textbook of just the various stages of meiosis that I've kind of had down here in the corner as we've been going through the process. Let me go back now and mention a couple of terms. I've already given you two of these terms, but I'm going to give you a couple more terms that we use of in talking about chromosomes. We talk about monads and dyads, and I've already told you about monads and dyads. A monad being a chromosome that's composed of simply one chromatid, and a dyad is a chromosome that's composed of two chromatids. So we already had those terms, monad and dyad. So you can go through these various stages of meiosis and ask at each stage, are the chromosomes monads or are they dyads? There's another set of terms that you often see, which is the term tetrad and bivalent. Tetrad and bivalent. Tetrad actually has a couple of meanings when we talk about meiosis and bivalent. In my way of thinking, I think your book uses a slightly different definition, but I think of these as the same. The tetrad and the bivalent are the chromosomes as they are synapsed. If you have two of these chromosomes that are together during prophase one that are synapsed, then this is a bivalent. It is two homologous chromosomes that have synapsed. We also call it a tetrad because it consists of four chromatids, two from this chromosome and two for that. So that's a tetrad, or it's a bivalent. Now, I said tetrad, unfortunately, has another meaning too. At the end of meiosis, you get four cells, right? The four cells that are produced at the end of meiosis are also called a tetrad. So there's really two meanings of tetrad related to meiosis. One is these synapse chromosomes, a pair of synapse chromosomes, because they consist of four chromatids, so it's a tetrad. But also the four cells that are produced at the end of meiosis are also called a tetrad. Interestingly enough, the four chromatids actually end up in the four tetrads. Those four strands end up one in here, one here, one here, and one there. So there is a relationship between those two meanings of tetrad. Okay, I want to complicate this for you a little bit. You need a few more complications, right, in talking about this. I want to complicate this just a little bit here as we look at the process as it occurs in higher animals. Meiosis as it occurs in higher animals. There's a diagram here that you'll see that illustrates meiosis as it occurs in animals, in males on the left and in females on the right. So let's look at meiosis as it occurs in males first on the left. It's fairly straightforward in males. In males, you start off, this is going to happen in the testis, in the gonad. In the testis, there is a cell that we start off with. It's a diploid cell. And we're going to call that cell, the original cell, we're going to call a spermatogonium. A spermatogonium. This diploid cell is a spermatogonium. The spermatogonium will at some point enter meiosis one. So here's the dividing line now where meiosis one starts. Once that cell enters meiosis one, still a diploid cell, but now we're going to call it a primary spermatocyte. Primary spermatocyte. That primary spermatocyte will divide at the end of meiosis one into two cells. And those two cells will enter immediately into meiosis two. And at that point, once they're in meiosis two, we're going to call them secondary spermatocytes. At the end of meiosis two, we get four cells, which are now haploid cells that we call spermatid. So four spermatids, which will mature into four sperm. Spermatozoa, it would be the correct term for spermatogoa. So these are the spermatid, and these are the spermatozoa, or sperm. So we go from one cell to four cells. Fairly straightforward process. I'm going to come back and talk about the timing of that in just a minute. How when this happens, let's say in an adult male. Well, in females, the process is a little bit different in that we start off with that diploid cell that we're going to call an oogonium. An oogonium. When the oogonium enters meiosis one, guess what we call it? We call it a primary oocyte. Primary oocyte. Meiosis one proceeds normally. But when you get to cytokinesis, one cell receives pretty much all the cytoplasm, and the other cell receives almost no cytoplasm. One of these cells, the oogonium and the primary oocyte are huge cells, by the way. If I drew these to scale, I'd have to draw this one, you know, bigger than the blackboard. It's much larger than this cell. It's a giant cell. And what happens is when cytokinesis occurs, one of these cells gets all the cytoplasm and the other hardly gets any at all. So we produce two cells. One of them we're going to call the secondary oocyte, the big one. The other one we're going to call polar body number one, or sometimes it's called the first polar body or polar body number one. Polar body number one is destined to die. It will not survive. The cell is putting all its eggs in one basket. It's putting all of its resources into this one cell to make this one egg. Meiosis happens perfectly normally. The cytokinesis occurs after meiosis one, but that cell gets no cytoplasm, so it dies, and only one cell survives. That cell then goes through meiosis two until cytokinesis at the end of meiosis two, and again, cytokinesis is uneven. One of the cells gets all the cytoplasm, and we're going to call that the ootid, and the other one gets almost no cytoplasm, and so it's polar body number two, or the second polar body, and it will also die. In some organisms, polar body one actually divides before it dies, but in most organisms, it ends up dying before it goes through meiosis two. So, and then the ootid will develop into the egg or the ovum. So what we have here is meiosis occurring just like it did in males, but at the end of meiosis one, one of the cells dies. At the end of meiosis two, one of the cells dies. So we started off with a single diploid oogonium, and we end up with just a single egg at the end, a single ovum at the end, simply because the other ones died off. So that's the first major difference. And this, again, is a conserving of the resources. This cell is this fertilized egg. Once it's fertilized by a sperm, it's going to have to do an awful lot. It's going to have to sustain life for the first few divisions. And so it's got all this rich cytoplasm and nutrients and RNA molecules and other stuff in it, packaged into it to take it through early development. So this happens both in animals and in plants. Plants, you see the exact same pattern. The egg is, you produce only one functional egg from one meiotic event. So that's the first major difference between meiosis as it occurs in males versus females. Now let me go back here and tell you about the timing of meiosis as it occurs in males versus females, this time human males versus females. Well, again, on the male side, it's pretty simple. This process does not start until puberty. But at puberty, it starts, and it pretty much then continues for the rest of life. It starts to peter off down here at the end of life when you used to get into the 50s and 60s and 70s. The whole process really becomes much, much slower. But you've all heard the stories of the 60-year-old, the 70-year-old man who's fathered a child. So it is possible to produce sperm cells down here. So on the male side of the process, which, by the way, I forgot to give the name of, we're going to call this process spermatogenesis. The genesis of sperm, spermatogenesis, and we're going to call this process oogenesis. In general, we could call this gametogenesis. Both of them together are gametogenesis, making the gametes. So in males, spermatogenesis begins at puberty and pretty much has no end. It's going to get less and less and less as the individual gets older. But in females, the timing is really quite fascinating. In human females, it's quite fascinating. Because the initial process going up to entering into meiosis one actually happens during the embryo stage. For all the females in the class today, all of the eggs that you have began meiosis while you were still an embryo in your mother's uterus. Meiosis begins in those cells, and all of the cells that are going to go through meiosis will go up through prophase one. They will actually have an arrest. They'll have a stop. We'll put up a stop sign here. It's a green stop sign. You should have a red stop sign. There's a stop sign. There is an arrest at prophase one. All of those cells go up through prophase one, but they freeze there. They stop at prophase one. They stay frozen at prophase one throughout the rest of embryology. When the baby is born, all the ovary has all these eggs frozen at prophase one in it. And all the way up to puberty, they stay at that stage. So this stop sign here I need to put, okay, that was embryo. So this is, we're embryo, childhood, and then up to the moment of puberty. At puberty, one of those cells every month, not all of them, one of those cells every month picks up from prophase one, finishes prophase one, gives off polar body number one, and goes as far as metaphase two, again, where there is a stop. This time at metaphase two. That one cell in the ovary picks up with meiosis one, finishes meiosis one, gives off that polar body, that second egg becomes a secondary oocyte, it goes through prophase one, it gets all the way up to metaphase one where the chromosomes are lined up, the sister chromatids haven't separated yet, but they're all lined up, and then it freezes again. And what is actually ovulated from the egg is technically not an egg. Excuse me, what is ovulated from the ovary? What is ovulated from the ovary is not an egg. It's actually a secondary oocyte that has stopped at metaphase two. It's sitting there in the middle of meiosis two at metaphase two. And that egg, that secondary oocyte, is ovulated from the ovary, swept into the fallopian tube, it's carried on down. If it is never fertilized, it'll pass right out, never getting beyond metaphase two. So in human females, meiosis is never completed unless the egg is fertilized. If the egg is fertilized, then very rapidly it will finish up meiosis two. It's sitting there at metaphase two, it doesn't have far to go, so it goes through anaphase two, telophase two, gives off polar body two, and in the meantime, the sperm has already entered, and then that new nucleus and the sperm nucleus will join together and form the zygote. So a very interesting timing phenomenon here is going on, in that there are two freezes in this process of meiosis. The first freeze happens while the female is still an embryo. All of the eggs in the ovary go up to prophase one, and then they stop while that female is still an embryo, and then they stay at that position. They stay at that stage throughout the rest of childhood, all the way up to puberty. But then even at puberty, only one a month will proceed on. So starting this month, one of those eggs goes up to metaphase two, and then it's ovulated at metaphase two. If it's not fertilized, then the next month another egg goes up to that stage and it'll be ovulated. Only if the egg is fertilized does it ever finish meiosis two, and then a zygote forms as the two nuclei fuse together. So this timing is a very interesting little quirk. But it turns out to also be important in something we're going to talk about a little bit later, and that is a type of chromosome mutation. When we start looking at the chromosome mutation of Down syndrome, there is a hypothesis that the reason Down syndrome occurs more often in older females is that in those older females, those eggs have been stopped at meiosis one for 30 years, 35 years, 40 years, and then finally that egg that was stopped at meiosis one for 40 years and a 40-year-old mother will finish up and finish meiosis one, and it ends up having a greater chance of the kind of chromosomal mutation we'll talk about later that causes Down syndrome. So just kind of put a little asterisk behind by this, and we'll come back and talk about this timing a little bit later. I should point out that a few years ago, there's a link on your outline that says eggs may be made throughout adulthood, ? Someone came up with some evidence that indicated that this hypothesis is wrong, that there are some cells that can start send cells into meiosis so that the meiosis actually starts later in life for the female. And that was a real shocker when that article came out. But you notice the next little link right after that says, or may not. Some people have tried to repeat that evidence and have found no evidence for those cells. So I guess it's one of those things we have to kind of put a question mark by. And so until someone proves it wrong, I'll go with the conventional wisdom that all of the eggs a female ever has have already started meiosis at the time that female is born. Whether or not some others, maybe in the future someone will find out that research was actually correct, but it was a real shocker when it was published a few years ago, but the recent work has not been able to duplicate that at all. Now, before I finish this process, this whole process with meiosis, I want to go back and talk about one more caveat, one more thing about this process, one more concept. I'm not going to go into this in any detail. It looks like I may have used a permanent marker, so I'll have to get the alcohol out to clean this off the board. So let me pause here for a minute so I can do that. I'll be right back to tell you one other little thing. Okay, let me take up one more question concerning meiosis, and that is a question of, if you're going through meiosis and you have a cell here, a diploid cell, divides into two cells at the end of by meiosis one, those two cells divide into four cells at meiosis two. We can say that this cell is definitely diploid. We can say that the four cells that we produce at the end are definitely haploid. What about the cells here? Are they diploid or are they haploid? It seems like a very simple question, but in analyzing it a little deeper, you see that it's not maybe quite that simple a question. Brings us back to the question of, what does it mean to be diploid? What does it mean to be haploid? At this point in my class, I always stop and I ask, what is this? Somebody out there, give me a definition of diploid. What is a diploid cell? What distinguishes a diploid cell from a haploid cell? Well, the key difference turns out to be not so much number of chromosomes. Yes, there's a difference in number of chromosomes. But it's not just a quantitative difference in the number of chromosomes. It is a qualitative difference in that diploid cells, to be diploid means that you have homologous chromosomes. You have homologous chromosome pairs. Whereas to be haploid means that you do not have homologous chromosome pairs. the presence of absent or absence of pairs of chromosomes. Homologous pairs is what makes is what diploidy and haploidy is all about. As you know, your life began, egg, sperm come together, and that egg had a set of 23 chromosomes from your mother, the sperm had a set of 23 chromosomes from your father, and after they came together, then you had 23 pairs of chromosomes, each pair, one from your mother, one from your father. And so we were illustrating those as a blue chromosome and a red chromosome, the one from your father being the blue one and the one from your mother being the red one. And there's a pair of homologous chromosomes. So a cell that looks like this, we would say, is diploid. Not so much because it has two chromosomes, because it has genetic material from two different sources. It has homologous chromosomes. It has one chromosome that came from your mother and one set of genes that came from your father. That's what makes it diploid. So what about these cells here? Well, let's go back and think about what we had for one of these chromosomes. Remember, as we were going through this process, we had started off with a chromosome that, we'll just look at one of these pairs. There's a pair of chromosomes. One came from your mother, one came from your father. But because of crossing over, at the end of meiosis one, this is what we had. We have reduced the chromosome number. We now only have a single chromosome where we had two here. Of course, you know, you've got 23 pairs like that. We're just looking at one pair. But we have only a single chromosome where we had two. But that single chromosome, with respect to this part of the chromosome, that cell is haploid. With respect to that part of the cell, that part of the chromosome, excuse me, with respect to that part of the chromosome, that cell is haploid. It only has genetic material from the mother. But with respect to this part of the chromosome, that cell is actually diploid. This cell, although there's only one member of each chromosome pair, in essence, that's not true. It really has pieces from that homologous pair. So this cell is partially haploid and partially diploid, because haploidy and diploidy are a qualitative thing, not a quantitative thing. Presence of homologous pairs. Are homologous pairs present? Well, for that part of the chromosome, no, they're not. For that part of the chromosome that you can see now, yes, they are. You can't see it, can you? For that part of the chromosome, the homologous pairs are present. Same thing for this one down here. This cell is now a partially haploid, partially diploid cell. Now, when we finish meiosis two, there's no longer any debate, right? At the end of meiosis two, I kind of did this funny, didn't I? But we'll do it like this anyhow. At the end of meiosis two, that chromatid's there, that one's there, this one's here, and that one's here. Now it's all haploid. It may have pieces from a different parent, but there's only one member of that pair. There's no homologous chromosome material. There's not another homologous chromosome that's red, let's say, for that part of the chromosome. So these cells are definitely haploid when you finish. So at the end of meiosis one, are the cells haploid or diploid? Yes, they are. They're both. They're both haploid and diploid due to crossing over. If crossing over had not happened, then at the end of meiosis one, they'd all be haploid. But because of crossing over, that cell is actually partially haploid and partially diploid. So I just wanted to point out that one little caveat in our basic understanding. A lot of times when we're talking about meiosis at a freshman biology level, we don't go into this kind of more complicated thing, and we say, well, you know, the cell becomes haploid here at the end of meiosis one. But that's really not true. The cell only becomes completely haploid at the end of meiosis two because of crossing over. Now that brings up one other little wrinkle that really causes some confusion, and I'm not going to worry about this, but I do want to at least point it out. In traditional textbooks, you will see it stated that meiosis one is a reductional division. And meiosis two is an equational division. What does that mean? Well, reductional goes from diploid to haploid. Equational, that's what reductional means. Equational means you're not changing the ploid. It either goes from diploid to diploid or haploid to haploid. So mitosis is equational. You take a diploid cell and you divide it by mitosis and you get diploid cells. So it's an equational division. So we often say at the freshman biology level, we say meiosis one is reductional and meiosis two is equational. To be honest, that's really not true. We don't usually get into this at the freshman biology level, and I even here students I know get very confused when I say this because it goes against everything you've learned in all your biology up to now. But to be honest, this is not a true statement, because meiosis one goes from a cell that's diploid to a cell that is partially diploid and partially haploid. So meiosis one is reductional with respect to that part of the chromosome, because we went from diploid to haploid, but it is equational with respect to this part of the chromosome, because we went from diploid to diploid. Yeah, we had more copies of it, but we had homologous chromosome material there, and we have homologous chromosome material here. So meiosis one, to be honest, is both reductional and equational. Meiosis two is also both reductional and equational, because here this cell was diploid with respect to that part of the chromosome, but now it's haploid. Both of these cells are haploid. So we reduced from diploid to haploid, but here we went from haploid to haploid, so it's equational with respect to the upper part of the chromosome. So this is something that modern biology textbooks, even modern genetics textbook, your textbook included, doesn't even touch this subject. I know you can go back 15, 20 years ago, and there was usually like a 2 or 3 page description of this and describing why this is true. But most people have just said, oh, this is too complicated. Let's not get into it. And so your book takes the easy way out and says, with respect to the centromere, meiosis one is equational and meiosis one is reductional and meiosis two is equational. And that's true if we're just looking at the centromere itself. We're not considering out there at the ends where these crossovers occurred. With respect to the centromere, we've gone from having two homologous centromeres to just one centromere. And now we've gone from a single centromere to two identical centromeres here. And so they simply take the easy way out. I have some references if you want to look at them. Don't lose any sleep over this idea right here of what reductional and equational, of this exception to reductional and equational is about. But I do want you to recognize that at the end of meiosis one, that cell is not a completely haploid cell if any crossover has occurred at all. It is a partially haploid and partially diploid cell. Because of the crossover, because diploidy is a qualitative thing, not a quantitative thing. It's not just counting the number of chromosomes. It's asking the question, is there homologous chromosome material present or not? And with that, we will end this topic of eukaryotic cell division.